Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints, now in our 25th year. My special co-host today is Joan Willshire, former executive director of the Minnesota State Council on Disabilities, now a disability consultant, and a very good one at that. My guest coming up today is David Voller, executive director and head of Shriners Children's. It's a nice clinic located over in Oakdale. It'll be celebrated its 100th anniversary pretty soon. And Joan, how are you today?
Doing great, and I have a fantastic guest with me today, and that is Erika Rivers. She's the new executive director of Wilderness Inquiry.
Good, and so we'll have all those things and a whole lot more coming up next on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. I'm honored today to have our new administrator for Shriners Children's in the Twin Cities, in Woodbury, as a matter of fact. David Voller is our new administrator, and we welcome him to the show. He's coming to us today by Zoom, and he's live from his office there in Woodbury. So welcome to the show, David.
Yeah, thank you. Glad to be here. Looking forward to our visit today and just really helping to maybe demystify is the best way I can think of it. What Shriners Children's is all about. So looking forward to visit.
Well, let's do that because I know that it has a whole new angle, and we've had the Believe and Achieve dinner recently, and we also had this year in Minneapolis, we had the Imperial Session. So we had the Shriners from all over the world basically coming up here, and we had an alumni day at the convention center at the same time. And that was really eye-opening and uplifting. From there on, I'll let you take, I want to start out by asking what new roads do you think Shriners is taking? I know that there have been a lot of changes out there. We're a clinic now, and one of the most well-known, renowned clinics around. So from there, I'll let you take what you really do.
Yeah, no, I think that's a good opening question, Mark. And when we think about where Shriners is going, I would say Shriners is going where much of healthcare is going. We're really rethinking and restructuring how healthcare is delivered. And it comes from a lot of domains of reasoning behind it. One, obviously, is just when you think about being fiscally responsible, the costs of how we had delivered care traditionally in the past have gotten so insurmountable that it's really hard to deliver care in the traditional or old model. But actually what's exciting about that is the way that we're delivering care today is really more complementary to that of where medicine has gone and where consumers are at. And what I mean by that is so much more of where healthcare has gone has led us to a point where we don't need all the brick and mortar. We don't need the extensive amount of inpatient space for patients to stay because patients just don't stay here anymore. So much more of what we do medically allows us to be able to serve patients in an outpatient, same-day ambulatory kind of way. The second element that I just mentioned is really that of the consumers, where consumers are at. And healthcare is truly in a market-driven industry, and in the 30 years I've been in healthcare, watching the evolution over the last 30 years of patients transforming from the dynamics of the way we traditionally have always offered healthcare to the consumer, it's now actually the consumer is really demanding how they want healthcare delivered and how they want to get it, where they want to get it, when they want to get it. And that can be everything from a traditional clinic visit in our clinics to a lot more virtual care. And maybe silver lining in what COVID brought is it really, really excelled our ability to really change up the model of care delivery with especially the telehealth care.
Yeah.
So that's where we're going.
Yeah, it's kind of on a menu basis.
We really are looking at what are those, I'll say, service domains that allow us to really change up some of the care that we provide and have provided in the past. And while historically, a lot of it has been for very complex children in a inpatient space environment. Because we've gone to more of an ambulatory care clinic model, we're now able to do a lot more things for all children, regardless of means to pay, to get care. And when we
that's
talk
where
about
I was,
that,
that's where I was going like that. Sorry, I took such a roundabout way.
Yeah, no, you did a great job of it, because what we're doing today, and again, because so much more of the care can be offered in an ambulatory way, we now can do a lot more around the therapies and support care for anything from spina bifida to scoliosis to the cranial helmet programs. And so much more of that care can be done in an ambulatory space better and more affordably than we did traditionally in the past. Right. And so that's giving us opportunity to start looking at offering more services. One of them that's just a small little gain, but it was huge to us. We now do sports physicals. And I think everybody would have kind of said, who would have ever thought Shriners Children's would be doing sports physicals? Well, why not? Let's get people in the door. Let's get them an opportunity to have a little bit of a taste of Shriners Children's.
That's a great idea. And the other thing that I guess I really enjoy is that you'll see more and more of the families getting involved. There was a time when they could, but they weren't as prevalent because the hospital served the seven states, or the hospital back then served the seven states. The clinic still serves the seven states, but you'll see the families getting more and more involved. And I think that is a great idea. You're going to heal faster. You're going to respond faster. There's a lot of reasons. We'd be here all day if I came out with quite a few of them. But anyway.
We think of a family unit now a little bit broader. We think of the family as caregivers. And what we really identify is that the unit that supports the patient may not be traditional family anymore. Yeah. It might be some other type of care service. It might be extended family, friends, neighbors. And so what that's doing for us is it's really helping us understand the many dynamics that go into serving a child and the care that they need and how they get it, not just here, but at home in the community. And so that's really opening our eyes to saying, how can there be a more holistic understanding of the care needs our patients have, again, not just here, but throughout their life and their environments.
A lot of the places have taken a holistic approach. And I think that has sped up, has done a lot of things. It's helped a person mentally, physically, it's sped up recovery. It's done a lot of things. And I think we do some of that there at Shriners Children's. Now, without me not being there every day, it's tough to tell. But I think a lot of that is done now. And there's a lot of good things to be said for that.
Yeah. Well, that holistic model of care is really exactly where CMS is trying to go. When you think about and look at the whole care coordination models, I mean, you look at everything from organizations like NCQA or the Joint Commission on the Ambulatory Model. Every bit of their framework and structure is about this whole care coordination and this more holistic care. And the reason being is that what you get for care might not just always be kind of, I guess, synergistic into one space, but it's everybody that plays a part, right? It takes a village to raise a child.
Absolutely.
And so now we're trying to do
a village and a lot of money.
Yeah, right. Well, and why have everybody repeat what somebody else has already done if we can just build off of that in a more collective way?
Well, and you have a good group there that if you're sitting in a conference room or medical conference has a good idea that spawns off to grow even bigger and helps the patient even more, and that's also important. And we have we have a good facility there, and it's one of the best in the country, I think. And we're getting down to about 2 or 3 minutes left, and I just want to say we also have a good PR department. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Lauren Elm. She's been there a lot of years. She's done a lot of great things, and she's going to continue to do more, I think. And
she's truly helping getting the word out there that, you know, Shriners Children's is still here in the Twin Cities market.
Yeah.
We serve the Dakotas, Nebraska, Iowa, Minnesota, Wisconsin, yep, and parts of Canada. And Lauren is really doing a great job of helping to expand and grow that representation that we are still here. We're alive and well. We don't do it in an inpatient care model anymore. We have different models and ways to handle those needs. But really, to be honest, Mark, probably about 92% of our patients now are cared for in an ambulatory space than in an inpatient space. So
great.
We just didn't need all that brick and mortar over in Minneapolis anymore.
Well, that's all right. We sold that to the University of Minnesota, and I understand they're doing great things with it.
Right.
Thing. We're getting down to the final word segment. So I want to be sure, where this interview is mighty important to me, that we didn't forget anything, and we want to do the final word segment. Anything?
I think, Mark, the message just really has to be, you know, we're a pediatric orthopedic care center. We serve all children, mm-hmm, regardless of it's a child who has an injury by falling on their trike to those children who are born with some kind of genetic defect. That's what we serve, but pediatric orthopedic is our business and what we're about. And we're really here to serve our communities nationwide, even worldwide.
Right, that's great. Well, David, it's been fun having you here today. Come on back and see us. You got a great staff over there. And also, you can always contact me for what it's worth. I happen to be Shriners product. So you contact me and I'll tell you all about it, and I'll send you over there. So please do keep these folks in mind. They're great. Again, David, thanks for being on Disability Viewpoints. We'll be back in just a minute. Thank you.
All right.
It's summertime and everybody wants to get outside right now in the great outdoors in Minnesota. And with me today to talk about how all of us, including people with disabilities, can get out there and have an accessible good time in the summer here in Minnesota is Erika Rivers, the new executive director for Wilderness Inquiry. Welcome, Erika.
Thank you, Joan. It's great to be here.
I know. We go back a ways with when you worked at DNR, Department of Natural Resources, for many years. Mm-hmm. You've got all these years of experience, and now you've landed this fantastic job.
Yes.
To really have fun.
Yes.
You get paid to have fun.
I get paid to have fun. That's
right. And create fun for others. So fantastic. So, well, let's get started right away, because there is so much that Wilderness Inquiry does for people mm-hmm. with disabilities, or just anyone who wants to get outdoors and enjoy Minnesota, right?
Right.
Winter, spring, summer, fall, right?
Yep, we are 365 days a year of outdoor fun.
Great. Well, why don't you start off? I know it's been around for years. What, 1978, mm-hmm. I think, was?
That's right.
It started?
Wilderness Inquiry is a 44-year-old nonprofit organization, and it was started by founder Greg Lace back in 1978. As you said, and the purpose, Greg had a point to prove way back then. There were some political folks who were arguing that the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness could not be a non-motorized recreation site because women, the elderly, and people with disabilities wouldn't be able to recreate there. And Greg set out, and a team of folks set out to prove them wrong, and took a group of 10 people out to the Boundary Waters in 1977, actually. Mm-hmm. And they portaged and had a grand old time. Some folks were living with physical disabilities. Some had blindness, and they made it on a wonderful many-day, 10-day trip, I think. And Wilderness Inquiry was born with the sole purpose of breaking down barriers to getting people outdoors and equitably enjoying the outdoors.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Well, so now fast speed up to today. Talk about the programs that exist and how people access them.
Mm-hmm. Well, Wilderness Inquiry offers a whole suite of programs. We offer day programs, which we do through a program called Canoe Mobile. And those are short trips, usually a few hours long. We do them on the Mississippi River, the Minnesota River, St. Croix River, Namekagon. These are accessible trips that if people experiencing disability have some additional supports that are needed, they can give us a call. ahead of time. We will work with them to accommodate those physical challenges and get them out in a boat, in a canoe. We find that canoe-based recreation, water-based recreation is a wonderful way to provide equitable access to the outdoors because you can really participate in the activity while on the water. So those are our day trips. And then we have three.
And they're all accessible, right?
Yes, they
people
are accessible.
People that use wheelchairs or have some kind of mobility and as well as sensory.
Yes, and one really cool trip that we're doing, the day trips are with, we call them ASL on the water. And so we bring sign language interpreters and have a wonderful employee working for us named Ritz Lightsky. And they are just a wonderful champion for the deaf and deafblind community.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're offering three actually this year, ASL on the water days as well. So yes, we are really in the business of trying to find ways to help
mm-hmm.
Break down the barriers that have typically limited people or, at least in their minds have limited people from full
right.
access to the outdoors.
So how do people access and get access to the programs?
Yeah. So there are a couple more programs that I would maybe highlight
for sure.
too.
Right. Okay.
So we also offer extended trips, which is really the bread and butter of what we have done mm-hmm. at Wilderness Inquiry. And we offer three different programs that are extended trips.
Hmm.
We offer one that's called Share the Adventure. These are fully integrated trips where folks who experience disability, those who don't experience disability, recreate together mm-hmm. in places like the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness, Voyageurs National Park, and mm-hmm. the Apostle Islands in particular. The second one is a program we called Families Integrating Together, and what we discovered was many families were not having holistic family experiences with the person experiencing disability.
Mm-hmm.
And so these programs are really targeted at family units, family groups, to make sure that the entire family is able to recreate together in the outdoors rather than going to separate locations. Mm-hmm. And then the final one is called the Gateway Program. And what this one is just really a confidence building program. It's finding ways to adapt to with a disability to mm-hmm. an outdoor recreation setting. So for an example, if somebody has some mobility issues in their hands and it's difficult to grab a canoe paddle, we introduce them to adaptive equipment that can help them get the paddle sure. in their hands and figure out how to mm-hmm. do the stroke so that they can meaningfully participate in the activity to,
right.
to the best of their ability.
Right.
And then once those skills are built,
mm-hmm.
They can go on, families integrating together trips or share the adventure trips. So I offer a whole suite, sort of soup to nuts of different programs to help people gain confidence and get outside.
So how many people a year utilize all these fun programs?
Yeah, so we have about 22,000. Pre-pandemic, we had about 40,000 people that we brought outdoors.
Sure.
Not all of them with disability or experiencing disability. But now, this last year, we had about 22,000
they're
serving.
Getting back up there.
Mm-hmm. And about 12 or 13% of people who we serve are people experiencing
sure.
disability.
Wow,
Yeah. Wow.
Age ranges, the people that are participating?
Yeah, so in the family trips, we have generally kids as young as 3 to 4 years old.
Wow.
And we have served folks who are in the upper 80s as well. So,
cool. So
and
aging.
Everything in between.
Yeah,
it's really awesome.
Wow. Now, I know you also do some research.
Mm-hmm.
Are you able to talk about some of the research? Because it looks very, very interesting.
And we do two kinds of research. One is really trying to make sure that we're breaking down barriers for people with disability. So finding locations and places where people experiencing disability can best recreate. We also have done quite a bit of research in our history, helping other public land agencies determine how accessible their facilities really are.
Wow.
And so Wilderness Inquiry has really led the way on that. In Minnesota here, they helped many years ago the state park system evaluate across the system how their transition plan was working, and then the trails, making sure
mm-hmm.
that or trying to really outline which trails were accessible for people in wheelchairs.
Right.
The other kind of research that we're really doing right now, too, is really the qualitative research. What we know from experiences in the outdoors is that people experience health benefits, mental health benefits, mm-hmm. physical health benefits, community and connectivity benefits, feeling together with one another when they spend time in the outdoors. And so we really want to measure the sort of inner benefits, the confidence sure. building right. and the sense of being and the sense of place and the calmness mm-hmm. and all of those kinds of sort of social emotional benefits of outdoor recreation. Right. And so we've been doing a lot of work in partnership with researchers at the University of Minnesota and North Carolina to really sort of create a large nationwide database. We're partnering with many right. other organizations mm-hmm. on this to really measure some of those, you know, a little less tangible benefits of being outdoors.
Right. Yeah. Well, let's talk just briefly, since you've mentioned some of the research around state parks. Mm-hmm. I know historically state parks have not been real accessible. So yeah. can you speak to that at all in terms of access and are mm-hmm. things improving and et cetera?
Right. Yeah. So in my previous role as director of Minnesota State Parks and Trails and worked with you and others right. at Minnesota Council on Disability to really do some comprehensive assessment of where the park system was in Minnesota or is in Minnesota. And, you know, what we learned through working with you at the council was, you know, there are lots of progress has been made across the system to make places, individual places, more mm-hmm. accessible. Good. An individual bathroom, as it got upgraded, became accessible. A visitor center became accessible. A mile or two a trail became accessible. But what we really wanted was for people experiencing disability to have a whole suite, a whole mm-hmm. 72 hours, a nice long weekend of accessible activity. And so most recently, we worked at William O'Brien State Park and worked with Minnesota Council on Disability and the Minnesota Legislature to really try to take a holistic look at that park and say, okay, how can we make it so there's 72 hours of outdoor recreation fun that's sure. accessible? Mm-hmm. And so we're making good progress on that. We have one of the it's actually called the Walter F. Mondale Day Use Area there now.
Wow.
Named
that's
after
really
a champion
nice.
Of outdoor recreation and conservation.
Mm-hmm. And that, where is that at?
That's at William O'Brien.
So that's located, William O'Brien is just yes. located outside kind of the metro area,
yes,
right?
It's a very easy drive from the metropolitan area, so lots of access for, you know, population mm-hmm. here in the metropolitan area. So yeah, it's definitely in progress, and the DNR, the commissioner's office, and leadership in the Division of Parks and Trails at the DNR is really very committed right. to accessibility in the outdoors in these spaces. It's
that
really awesome.
Fantastic.
Yes.
So how do you suggest people figure out they've never done this before, yeah. they've never really been outside that much because it hasn't been accessible? Mm-hmm. What do? Do they just go to your website and pick a I'll go here and try canoeing.
Yes, that is one wonderful way to start is go to the Wilderness Inquiry website. It's wildernessinquiry.org. And there's
can you say that one more time?
Wildernessinquiry.org.
Okay.
And so if you go to that website, you can find a trip and, choose your destination. You can choose depending on where you're at. If you're
sure.
feeling like you really need to build some skills, there's always the gateway programs. If you just want to try a day trip and see how it works out, there are lots of public mm-hmm. Programs that we can usually get people out in those boats to experience
and
that.
And are there people that kind of come with you too to
right on?
You know, if you
yeah.
can't lift things, if you can't figure things out, I mean, so you're just not almost some. I have no idea how to do this.
That's a really great question. We really try to be the best source of support that we can
sure.
for folks. And so what will happen is if you have interest, you can sign up for the program on the website. And then when they'll get the information indicating that you may have some supports that are needed, you get a phone call from one of our customer service agents. And they will walk through what kinds of supports are needed for that trip. We have a whole network of volunteers who love to trip assist in these, either
sure.
day trips or
right.
extended trips. And they will hook up the right levels of support with the participant. So we've been doing it for a long time.
Right. So you've got all the bells and whistles pickled out,
we
don't
do.
You?
We do.
Wow. That mm-hmm. is fantastic. And it sounds like it. Just pick a trip.
Pick a trip, and we'll see how we can accommodate it.
Well, mm-hmm. That is fantastic.
Now, there, I should say just a caveat, because there's always the downer on this, too, which is just, you know, there are some things that are difficult. It's hard to get medication that requires a certain temperature, like a refrigeration, into the boundary
sure.
waters. So we can't say that we can get everywhere, everybody everywhere, but we sure will try.
Wow. Yeah. So you do try to meet everybody's needs almost to a T, it sounds mm-hmm. like.
We really do.
Wow. That is just fantastic. So any final words you want to say? You know, I mean, it sounds like you're enjoying it as a new executive director. Mm-hmm. Replacing Greg Leas, who
yes.
was fantastic, the original
yes.
guy who created it.
Greg is still such a wonderful champion of Wilderness Inquiry, and, mm-hmm. and he really built a very an incredible organization. We're in the middle of our strategic planning process right now,
right.
So we are very actively thinking about what the next generation of WI, or Wilderness Inquiry, is going to be. We remain mm-hmm. today in 2022 as committed to access to the outdoors, and breaking down barriers for people with disabilities, as well as those who face other structural barriers to recreating outdoors.
Right.
The vision is just more of the great work that has already begun.
And I know you talk about inclusion to the outdoors, and that's the buzzword,
yes.
the inclusion, so that's great.
Yes.
One last time, the website where people can access Wilderness Inquiry.
Yeah, just go on the web and go www.wildernessinquiry.org.
Great. Well, fantastic having you on. Good to see you.
It's wonderful to see you too, Joan.
And good luck in everything you're going to be doing and with Wilderness Inquiry. It's fantastic.
Thank you.
Great. Well, we're wrapping this up and with another story here for Disability Viewpoints, and we'll be right back after these messages.
Well, we hope you enjoyed our show. Our Disability Viewpoint show. David Voller is, I've just met him, and he's one of the most intelligent men I think I've ever met. He's got a lot of new ideas for Shriners Children, so we'll have to have him back on and have him update us on as to what he's going to do next. That was a great guest, and we certainly learned a lot in about 13 minutes. So, Joan Willshire, I know you had a great guest. I think
absolutely. Erika Rivers, the new executive director for Wilderness Inquiry, is fantastic. She's going to keep the programs that have been so successful at Wilderness Inquiry and certainly moving forward with some new ones as well. So we all better hurry up and get outside in this great Minnesota weather.
You bet. As Minnesota bound, it's a introduce a kid to the great outdoors. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching. On behalf of Joan Willshire and the entire team at SPN, and we'll see you again soon. Bye for now.